The Energiewende was founded in 2007, 2008 on the basis that energy costs were high and were going to continue to rise forever. And it now needs to adjust to a more competitive world in which other countries, particularly the United States, have much lower energy costs, which is attracting investment from Germany to the United States in a very significant way. And the costs of the Energiewende themselves have reached a limit that the economics minister of Germany recently has said is unsustainable. So Germany needs to move from a high-cost Energiewende to what we call in our new study a more competitive Energiewende, which really means reform of the Energiewende. Well, we've spent the last 9 months working on our study on the Energiewende and what it means for the German economy and how to move towards a more competitive Energiewende. Certainly, there are kind of three major things that really stand out. One is slowing down the kind of immature and new technologies in renewables to keep it within a reasonable cost frame, because as it is now, Germany is committed to 185 billion euro bill just for what's already been installed for renewables, and so not continuing to move at the very rapid rate and having costs go up. Secondly, is in fact Germany has substantial natural gas resources. It used to produce 20% of its gas. It's now down to 10%, and it has what seems to be significant shale gas potential, and so it should look with a very balanced, pragmatic, non-emotional way at developing that and look at models around the world and see how it's been developed elsewhere. And thirdly, we see that these rebates that the large industrial consumers receive, so-called rebates, now a subject of debate with the EU and Brussels, have been important, and that, well, if they were not there, German industry would be at a much more competitive disadvantage, and the impact of that would be measured in really big loss in terms of GDP, and you could be looking at a million job loss in terms of employment as a result of that. So Germany faces some big, tough questions in terms of reforming its Energiewende, but I think there's been an evolution over the last 6 months and among the political leadership to see that the need is there. And when you have the economics minister, the leader of the Social Democratic Party, saying that if Germany does not reform its Energiewende, it faces a dramatic deindustrialization, that's a very important message, and it says that change will come. One of the really big unexpected things that's happened in the world economy in the last half decade is this development of shale gas and tight oil in the United States, and the numbers are quite extraordinary. 44% of U.S. natural gas now is shale gas. The U.S. has now overtaken Russia as the world's largest gas producer, and one of the consequences is that the United States is not only attracting a lot of industry, both energy intensive and also other companies that supply or for whom these are customers, but also that the United States is moving to become an LNG exporter, something that would have been thought inconceivable a half a decade ago. And by 2020, 2022, the United States will likely rank with Qatar and Australia as one of the world's three largest LNG exporters. So the role of the United States in the world energy market, in the global energy system, is really going through a very profound change. The initial concern when the Ukraine crisis erupted is what would it mean for gas supplies, because people remember what happened in 2006 when there was an interruption of Russian gas through Ukraine, and again in 2009. So far, there has not been an interruption of the gas supplies, but what it has done is focused attention on what is the flexibility of the gas system in Europe, what is the ability to move gas around and respond to crises, and Europe has done a lot after 2006, 2009 to be prepared for that. And I think what it's also done is once again focused attention on that recurrent and very important question of energy security now and in the future.